Today we have with us Richard Middleton, Dr. Richard Middleton, who is a professor of biblical worldview and exegesis at Northeastern Seminary. And he's coming to start off this series with this question, is it okay to question God? Some of us may say an automatic yes to that. Some of us might go, oh no, we can't question God. But he's coming to share with us from the scripture today. So let's welcome Dr. Richard Middleton as he comes to share with us.
Am I on? Good. Good morning, everybody. It's great to be here. So what I'm going to do is just answer the question in one word. Yes. But I'm going to say a little more than that. I want to read you a scripture from Jeremiah chapter 20. Then I want us to play a song, and I want the volume to be really loud. We're going to go straight to the song when the scripture is over, and then I'm going to do a message on the scripture that will bring the song into it. Jeremiah 20. O Lord, you deceived me, and I was deceived. You overpowered me and prevailed. I am ridiculed all day long. Everyone mocks me. Whenever I speak, I cry out, proclaiming violence and destruction. So the word of the Lord has brought me insult and reproach all day long. But if I say, I will not mention him or speak any more in his name, his word is in my heart like a fire shut up in my bones. I am weary of holding it in. Indeed, I cannot. I hear many whispering, terror on every side. Report him, let's report him. All my friends are waiting for me to slip, saying perhaps he'll be deceived. Then we will prevail over him and take our revenge on him. But the Lord is with me like a mighty warrior. Amen? So my persecutors will stumble and not prevail. They will fail and be thoroughly disgraced. Their dishonor will never be forgotten. O Lord of hosts, you examine the righteous and probe the heart and mind. Let me see your vengeance on them, for to you I've committed my cause. Sing to the Lord, give praise to the Lord. He rescues the life of the needy from the hands of the wicked. Cursed be the day. Not done. Sorry. You see, you think that's where it would end, but that's not where the prayer ends. Cursed be the day I was born. May the day my mother bore me not be blessed. Cursed be the man who brought my father the news, made him very glad, saying, a child is born to you, a son. May that man be like the towns the Lord overthrew without pity. May he hear wailing in the morning, a battle cry at noon, for he did not kill me in the womb with my mother as my grave. Her womb enlarged forever. Why did I ever come out of the womb to see trouble and sorrow and to end my days in shame?
That you made in your image, see them starving on their feet, 'cause they don't get.
I don't know which is worse, telling God you don't believe in him or that he has deceived you. At least the song we heard just starts respectfully, "Dear God." But Jeremiah begins his prayer audaciously with, "Lord, you deceived me and I was taken in. You tricked me and I fell for it. You enticed me. You seduced me." That verb for deceived, it's the same verb used elsewhere in the Old Testament for a man sweet talking a woman to rape her, or for Israel being seduced by idols. It sounded good, Lord, when you called me to be a prophet way back in chapter 1. It sounded good when I objected that I was too young and that I wasn't good with words. You assured me that you would be with me to protect me, that you would put your words in my mouth. Sounded good, Lord. You sure sweet-talked me. But it was all hollow words because you didn't live up to your end of the bargain. When they put me on trial for treason because I spoke your words, that Jerusalem, the holy city, would fall to the Babylonians. When they put me under house arrest, when they put me in the stocks on public display like a criminal for all to mock me, when they threw me in a dried up old well and I nearly died, in fact it was dry, it was not that much consolation, thank you very much, where were you then? You weren't there. You didn't protect me from any of it. Boy, did you ever sweet talk me. You deceived me and I was taken in. 5 chapters earlier in chapter 15, when Jeremiah has not yet come to this horrifying conclusion about God, he prays pleadingly, "Don't be to me like a deceitful brook. Don't be like a dried up old watercourse that early on has a trickle with a promise of a thirst-quenching stream further on, which entices a weary desert traveler to pull up his tents and flocks and follow for miles, only to dry up on me? Don't be like that," Jeremiah prays in chapter 15, verse 18. But here in chapter 20, he has reached the end of the watercourse, and the stream is dry. It isn't as if Jeremiah has any choice in the matter either. "You didn't just sweet talk me," he says in his prayer. "You overpowered me and prevailed. Lord, when you called me to be a prophet, you said," and I quote, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart and appointed you to be a prophet. So what choice did I have in that? None at all. You coerced me." And I had no choice in what to say either. So what did I say? Every time I opened my mouth, all that came out was violence and destruction, doom and gloom. Didn't you have anything positive to say to these people, Lord? Nothing I could say that was hopeful? Nothing but judgment? God will judge you for your sins. The city will be destroyed. You think people like hearing that all the time? Why do you think I was in trouble with the law? Why do you think I was always ostracized? And not just by the citizens of big city Jerusalem, who had to bear the brunt of your message, but even the folks back home in small town Anathoth. They turned against me. All my so-called friends deserted me. Why do you think I cried out back in chapter 17, "Woe is me, my mother, that you ever bore me, a man of strife and contention with the whole land. I did not sit in the company of merrymakers, nor did I rejoice, but under the weight of your hand I sat alone. For you have filled me full of wrath." And who wants to listen to that all the time? "Yeah, I know you warned me back in chapter 1 there'd be opposition. You told me that you'd make me like a fortified city, an iron pillar, a bronze wall to stand against the whole land, and they'll fight against you," you said, but "they will not prevail against you," I'm quoting you now, "for I am with you to deliver you." Well, you don't need to deceive me or prevail against me, because they're doing a fine job of it already. Not only did I have no choice in what to say, words which brought me insult and reproach all day long, but when I tried to be silent and hold back those negative words, your words were within me like a burning fire, scorching my bones, and I couldn't hold them in. It was to no avail. You win, you prevail. Whether I speak or try to be silent, I get burned. I have no choice before your raw power, Lord. You didn't just sweet talk me, you forced me. When Jacob wrestled the angel by the river at night, in the end, though he was injured and walked with a limp after, the Bible says he prevailed with God and man. But Jeremiah makes no headway on either the human or the divine front. He was blocked at every turn. And so one of the greatest prophets in the Bible reaches his lowest ebb in Jeremiah chapter 20. He felt deceived, overpowered, abused, and abandoned, not just by those around him, but by God. So what do you do when God seems to have led you down the garden path and either shuts the gate on you, or worse, the path ends in a precipice, and there you stand, tottering on the edge of despair, your way blocked by financial crisis, by a broken relationship, by the untimely death of a close friend or loved one, or if not by one major hurt or crisis that leaves you reeling with vertigo on the edge of a precipice, then maybe by the accumulated sadness of multiple disappointments over time. What do you do when your dreams and expectations, legitimate dreams of a good life, a life that experiences some modicum of God's blessing and fulfillment, what happens when those dreams are thwarted again and again? I have no idea how refugees from Syria have survived the violence and devastation of their home country, emotionally and spiritually, even if they've survived physically, and how they've survived the long trek to other nations that could receive them, and now which don't receive them. How would survivors of major earthquakes or tsunamis experience their lives when their loved ones and all their possessions are wiped out in one fell swoop? What would you think of God if you were a survivor of, say, the tribal massacres in Rwanda in the 1990s, or the killing fields of Cambodia in the 1970s? A God that would allow that kind of thing to happen? And I have no idea how those who lived through the nuclear bombing of Hiroshima or Nagasaki could possibly feel, much less think about God, whom Christians claim is a God of love and who cares about us and our suffering. But perhaps worst of all for me, because I am ethnically Jewish, is the death, the cold-blooded extermination of 6 million Jews under the bureaucracy of Nazi Germany. What would it be like to live and see and maybe outlive the ovens of Dachau or Auschwitz? Well, let's hear from a survivor, shall we? Elie Wiesel in his book, Night. Wiesel, or the narrative persona Wiesel has in the book, was about a 14 or 15-year-old boy at the time. In front of us, flames. In the air, the smell of burning flesh. It must have been about midnight. We'd arrived at Birkenau, reception center for Auschwitz. Never shall I forget that night, the first night in camp, which has turned my life into one long night, 7 times cursed and 7 times sealed. Never shall I forget that smoke. Never shall I forget the little faces of the children whose bodies I saw turned into wreaths of smoke beneath a silent blue sky. Never shall I forget those flames which consumed my faith forever. Never shall I forget that nocturnal silence which deprived me for all eternity of the desire to live. Never shall I forget those moments which murdered my God and my soul and turned my dreams to dust. Never shall I forget those things, even if I am condemned to live as long as God himself. Never. What can you say to an experience like that? It's clear to me what you can't say. You can't simply tell victims or survivors of something like that, you know, God is in charge and God is good and God has a purpose for all that. So I agree with the Jewish scholar Irving Greenberg when he said, no statement, theological, that is a statement about God or otherwise, no statement should be made that would not be credible in the presence of the burning children. So what can you say? Maybe you could say, oh Lord, you deceived me. That would work. Maybe like the song, Dear God, you can tell God that we need a big reduction in the amount of tears, or that the hurt I feel helps to compound that Father, Son, and Holy Ghost is just somebody's unholy hoax. Perhaps you can even tell God, if there's one thing I don't believe in, it's you. Notice what both Jeremiah's prayer and the song, Dear God, have in common. They're both honest, brutally honest, and honest about what they think of God. But more importantly, they're both prayers. They address God with the pain. Is it okay to question God? That's a trivial question compared to what Jeremiah does. Like many such prayers in the Bible, especially in the Psalms and the book of Job, these are lament or protest prayers that take all the pain and the hurt and the despair of life and they place it at the feet of God. Or they even hurl it in God's face and they say, "This is your stuff. Do something about it, because if you don't, nobody else will." There's something paradoxical about that song, "Dear God." The singer tells God in no uncertain terms that he, or maybe it's a she at the end, can't, doesn't believe in him. Yet it's a prayer addressed to God. And right at the point where that final climactic statement of the denial of faith comes, the song says, "If you're up there, you'd perceive that my heart's here upon my sleeve." So why pray to God and tell God you don't believe in him? Because you desperately want to. This song, like all prayers of lament, is a cry for help. And thus, it is a bold affirmation of faith. Prayers of lament are redemptive and healing, because when you take your pain and your hurt and your sense of betrayal and you take it to God in gut, honest prayer, it doesn't have to be theologically correct prayer, but it has to be honest. When you take your pain to God, you're saying in effect, "Lord, help my unbelief. Lord, I believe, help my unbelief." Or the song, "Dear God," maybe the song would be saying, "I don't believe, help me to believe." And God can handle it. God handled Jeremiah's prayer just fine. God handles all the psalms of lament just fine. So my assigned topic in this chapel is it okay to question God? Not only is it okay to question God, the psalms of lament and Jeremiah's prayer make it clear that we're invited to challenge God. Maybe your pastor can't handle that, but God certainly can. Not only can God handle it, God wants us to take our pain and hurt and sadness and doubt to him, all the disorientation of our lives. And God invites us to pour out our laments before the throne of the Most High. Why else do you think Jeremiah's prayer is in the Bible? Or the many lament psalms, fully one-third of all the psalms, the most common form of prayer in the Bible, challenges God. We Christians have forgotten about that. That's in the Bible. Or take the book of Job, 42 long chapters of Job's complaint to God, with his friends constantly telling him his suffering must be his own fault, or that God has a good purpose for it, and God wants to teach him something. And Job doesn't believe them. He persistently tells them he doesn't deserve what's happening to him, and God's responsible. "I want God to answer me," Job says. And God answers Job, but doesn't explain why Job suffered. But God tells Job's friends that in their attempts to defend God, they have, quote, "not spoken to me what is right, as my servant Job has." In fact, they didn't speak to God at all. It doesn't matter that Job's lament is not quite theologically correct. He took it to the Most High, the one who really wants to hear it. And as if to make it crystal clear to us that God wants us to take our questions and our suffering and our doubts to him in honest prayer. Even Jesus in the garden was honest both with the disciples and with the Father. When they went to Gethsemane, he began to be distressed and agitated, says Mark 14. And he said to them, "I am deeply grieved even to death. Remain here and keep awake." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. And then on the cross, in the midst of his most excruciating suffering, Jesus prays Psalm 22, a psalm of lament. "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani? My God, why have you forsaken me?" Is it okay to question God? There's a good example. When we have the audacity and also the faith to lay our pain at God's feet and summon the Most High into our suffering, something remarkable happens. God comes. Lament prayers like Jeremiah 20 have their roots ultimately in the Exodus. The Exodus is the central and founding event of the Old Testament when God delivered the Israelites from Egyptian bondage. Central to the story of the Exodus as it is remembered in Scripture, though we often forget this part of it, is the Israelites' primal scream of pain to God. Between centuries of accumulated suffering and God's sending of Moses, the Redeemer, we find this remarkable statement in Exodus 2. The Israelites groaned in their slavery and cried out. And their cry for help because of their slavery went up to God. And God heard their groaning and remembered his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So God looked on the Israelites and was concerned about them. That agonized cry of pain at the heart of the Exodus echoes resoundingly throughout every prayer of lament, including Jeremiah 20, and the song, Dear God, and all the groanings of our hearts. So lament is redemptive, not simply because in it you cling to God in desperate faith. More fundamentally, lament is redemptive because it's rooted in the very pattern of the biblical story. At the hinge, indeed the fulcrum between bondage and deliverance. And that's true not just in the Old Testament, it's true also in the New Testament. For as the Gospels tell us, 3 days after Jesus' own lament, his cry of abandonment on the cross, God acted decisively, defeating the power of death and raising Jesus from the dead. That's the Exodus pattern. But more than this, the cross itself is God's response to the lament of all creation. For creation itself, says Romans 8, is groaning in its bondage to decay, subject to futility, and yearning eagerly for redemption and release. And we ourselves groan inwardly, says Paul, as we anticipate the coming redemption. And it is in anticipation of deliverance that Jeremiah suddenly switches from his lament and protest to a positive affirmation of trust in verse 11. The Lord is with me like a mighty warrior, so my persecutors will, ultimately, not prevail. And then in verse 13, he soars to new heights. Sing to the Lord, praise the Lord, for he rescues the life of the needy from the hands of the wicked. And then that's where the psalm came in, miscued. Because right after soaring to new heights, Jeremiah crashes to new depths. And his prayer ends with an extended curse on the day of his birth. He doesn't curse God, but as one whose life of suffering seemed fated from the womb, he wished he had never been born. And the prayer ends with a poignant question. Why did I ever come out of the womb to see trouble and sorrow and end my days in shame? Why did Jeremiah come crashing down from the heights of praise and thanksgiving? Maybe because that praise and thanksgiving were too quick, too easy, even forced. It's not that he didn't believe that God could or would deliver him. The trouble is that believing that doesn't always help. When you're in the bottom of the pit, on the edge of the precipice, often the recognition of what God could do but hasn't done yet can just make things worse. The gulf, the heightened contrast between that future promise of God's blessing and restoration and the present reality of suffering and brokenness. That gulf can intensify the pain and enhance your despair, as I can testify. Especially when it's precisely your heightened expectations that have been dashed. So I've come to realize that my hope in times of suffering and doubt, which are more pervasive than I'd like to admit, is not rooted simply in the redemptive future God has promised, that is Easter Sunday, which is coming, but it's rooted in the present, in Lent and in Good Friday. Hope is rooted not simply in God's promise to one day undo the wrong and triumph against evil. I've come to see in a new light the remarkable biblical truth that God in Christ chose the way of the cross. Not just that we might share the power of the resurrection, but that God might share our pain. And when Jesus on the cross cried, my God, why have you abandoned me? Something happened that is beyond any human explanation. And the session we're going to have explaining what the cross is about, still not going to explain it fully. God was in Christ, says the Bible, reconciling the world to himself. When on the cross, all the evil and pain and suffering and despair of the world and of our lives exploded like a million megaton atomic bomb on Jesus and ripped him from the presence of the Father and cast him into the pit of deepest, darkest abyss. He descended into hell, says the creed, into the deepest place. And now God has known the darkness, poured out in compassion on behalf of the world. As the writer Oz Guinness once said, only this God has wounds. In many of the poignant stories he relates in his book, Night, Elie Wiesel tells of the torture and public hanging of a young boy by the SS. This young boy was well beloved by everyone of all the prisoners. When the noose was placed around the boy's neck, Wiesel heard someone behind him say, "Where is God? Where is he?" Fully half an hour later, after the chair was tipped over and the boy was still alive, twitching in silent agony because his weight was too light to break his neck, Wiesel heard a voice behind him say, "Where's God now?" And Wiesel said, "I heard a voice within me answer, 'Where is he? Here he is. He's hanging here on this gallows.'" From the perspective of biblical faith, perhaps Wiesel's answer was truer than he knew. So, is it okay to question God? Ultimately, God took all the pain of the world into himself on the cross to give us back redemption. In comparison to that, what's a little questioning? Let us pray. May the grace of the Father, God, the suffering love of Christ, and the presence of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us today and into the future. Amen.